Kunde, who want to go into this lecture today on microeconomics.
203.
The topics for the day is
basically on what we call permanent income hypothesis.
Permanent income hypothesis, as propounded by Milton Friedman in his theory of permanent income hypothesis. The outline goes dust. I'm going to discuss this on this particular discussion on investment functions, the technology, the new technology, as it is were, then decisions to invest, and of course the three approaches in investment and so on and so forth. And this is how we are going to approach the studies today. Basically, permanent income hypothesis as a sponge by Milton Friedman. He tried to give an explanation, you know, on the apparatus, on the theory of intertemporal choices. It was first put forth by Milton Friedman as part of the life cycle hypothesis or explanation. But for this explanation, he went further to argue that people as a person or individual take account of future income and future consumption possibilities when planning current consumption in changes in is measured. Income will only affect current consumption by ways of resulting changes in wealth, meaning that there are other factors that is being put into consideration when you are trying to budget. Budget is a function of so many variables. One, you look at it from your income, you look at it from your permanent income and transitory, and so on and so forth. Now, of course, the money you earn on wealth, which is equally a function of interest rate, and the money that you have acquired over the years, and how can we be pushed forward into your consumption, and so on and so forth. And this is how he's trying to explain. A typical household permanent income is a return on this human and non-human. Non-human wealth is defined wealth as present value of the future flow of income, which tend to restable over the long run. And this is how he trying to expatiate his theory. Any positive or negative impact on this parallel is treated as transitory impact. Permanent consumption is that part of consumption expenditure which data shows to be regarded as necessary by household and the consumer. The four elements of permanent income per consumption are one, transitory consumption from the build below, as we are going to see in our discussion in the hypothesis. One, income is a function of not only income but permanent income plus income transitory. Those are the two areas. Number two, consumption is going to be a function of permanent income plus consumption based on transitory, as Y is a function of Y bar subscript lower plus T stand as transitory income. And then number two, again, we can use a consumption as a function of CP subscription P and C and T, that is transitory. And finally, the third discussion, according to Milton Friedman, is that consumption is a function of permanent, that is lower subscript, and K, that is is the parameter we use in discussing what are all the variables that we use in forming our consumption discussion, and that is I. I here stand as interest rate, then wealth. wealth, that is the money that you made, either in terms of investment you have made, in terms of asset, in terms of what other things you have done, and so on and so forth. But of course, you here, could stand up all that variable, woman and non-woman asset. And of course, why is all that is variables that are not taken into considerations. And these are the ways in which Mr. Friedman trying to portray his argument in trying to put it in terms of equation format. The third equation gives the relationship between permanent income and permanent consumption. He said that the relationship between permanent income and permanent consumption depends on the permanent income, which is in turn depends on the permanent income and income and permanent trajectory. Consumption depends on permanent income, which in turn depends on source variables, as we have discussed before. I stand for interest rates, the rate of interest, relation between consumer income from his property and his ability, and the consumer's preferences on the immediate consumption as opposed to his addition to these world. And those are what he started before, that there are other variables that I will be put into considerations in judging the permanent income hypothesis. And those are the parameters that stand for the function, which is the bracket I, that is interest rate, wealth, and the other non-human wealth, and so on and so on and so forth. So these are the areas that he make his own theory different from other predecessors like Keynes and James Duzenberry, as the case may be. Such variables as I and the rate of interest, relationship between consumer income from his property and his ability and the consumer preference on immediate consumption as opposed to his addition to his wealth. Milton Friedman only want to tell us that we are to budget our expenditure on our permanent income. That is, we budget on our permanent income. There could be either some other money coming into us like gifts or grant, as opposed to other government gifts or assistance, and so on and so forth. So those are the thinking that really inform most of these household, business, and government in terms of trying to back on infrastructure development, in terms to grow the economy, and so on and so forth. And this is a very, very fundamental theory that differentiate himself from other predecessors. And of course, those can really count on our budgeting, since it is not permanent. Don't say that we get as gift or grant. So he said that we have to plan our budget in such a way that our monthly salary will see us through, will take us to the end of the month. But when we start getting our money from at the beginning, we may feel good. Or just like some students will say, look, they'll have a 0-0 or 1-1 or 0-0-1 or 0-0-2, as the case may be. But at a starting point, you will feel good. Maybe you'll be eating three square meals in a day. But by the middle of the month, you will begin to have a 0-1-1, or as the case may be. So by the middle of the month, we start going hungry, which is feeling ill at the starting point, and feeling maybe 0-1-1, as the case may be, at the end of the day. That could be equally be demonstrated by this graph which we use in most of our analysis. This graph, we'll look at it in this way. When the starting month, the beginning of the month, you feel very good that you can be eating 1-1-1, that is 3 times a day. As a month continue to go pregnant, you begin to have 0-1-1. And when the month begins to grow very, very slim, then of course we have 0-0-1. These are used to demonstrate, especially the student of economics, so that if you're able to always base your calculation, your budgeting on what you really come to your pocket, not what actually you expect to get in terms of a gift, in terms of a grant, as the case may be. And these are very important in our analysis on permanent income policies by Mr. Freeman. Again, we're going to investment function. What are those functions that actually build us in knowing how to relate the variables in terms of investment and so on and so forth? So investment functions is a relation between the autonomous and the replacement investment. And these are very important. The investment, the function of I, that is autonomous plus investment as a function of interest rate. And then again, it can equally be discussed as investment is a function of income. And of course, when you look at that relationship, we can now look at that GDP, as we rightly discussed in the beginning of our lectures last month, we now look at GNP. It's a function of what? It's a function of aggregate demand, and that will give what we call total purchases. Total what? Total purchases. In a given economy. And of course, that can equally be related in terms of aggregate demand. We don't talk of aggregate demand, we're talking about the totality of the economy in terms of what we produce at a particular point in time. And that again will be brought into focus in terms of consumption or aggregate demand. It's a function of consumption, investment plus government plus export minus import, or we can equally change this to what we call a foreign trade sector. Again, we have discussed this on one sector model, two sector model, three sector model, four sector model, as the case may be. And these are the thinking of these investment function in macroeconomics. These are assumptions based on both who want to look into it. These are basically assumptions, which is realistic in a way. And how do we now help us in determining our investment function? So that investment is helping us determine what that means. This is an assumption which is based on implying that investment cannot be determined with a model. As you see in the model, as I say here, the investment cannot be determined within here. And this investment, if you bring it out as this equals to, it's a function of autonomous plus interest rate, which is a function of investment, as the case may be. Aggregate demand, that investment function is a function of so many variables. And that could be done in such a way that aggregate demand is a function of consumption plus investment, government, and foreign trade sector. If you look at it in that angle, we can equally use that aggregate demand is a function of consumption, investment, government, plus export, minus import, as the case may be. And these are based on consumption, assumption, a very realistic assumption, and so on and so forth. This could be planned investment and include expenditure on plant and equipment as well as planned inventory changes. Okay. However, there is need to differentiate between land and as opposed to realize actual investment. The two do not always correspond. After realizing actual investment, this lead to induced investment. What are those inducement? Induced investment means that investment depends on income as well as other factors. What are those other factors? We have interest rate, we have income, we have permanent money to invest, and so on and so forth. So if we differentiate it with the YDS and the YR, then of course it will give us the differentiation of this particular thing, which will become I equals to IO, that is autonomous, plus I, it's a function of income. And when you differentiate that, that will give us the I, the Y, will give us to I equals to NPI, with marginal propensity to invest, and so on and so forth. And these are very, very important in our macroeconomic discussion. And of course, we cannot look at it like investment is a function of autonomous plus interest rate, which means that I is less than zero. And of course, if you look at it again on another dimension, I is less than zero, or I equals to zero, or I zero plus I interest rate and other variables, and so on and so forth. And when you differentiate the I over the I, the inverse, that is respecting with respect to investment and income, that means that will give us what we have, MPI less greater than zero, and so on and so forth. And these are the ways in which we discuss in investment, especially in macroeconomics.